This channel has been established for visually impaired people. For the visually impaired people, voice narration and a written expression are also provided for the hearing impaired. Don't forget to subscribe to our channel. Edward Drinker Cope, July 28, 1840 to April 12, 1897 was an American paleontologist and comparative anatomist, as well as a noted herpetologist and ichthyologist. He was a founder of the Neo-Lamarckism school of thought. Born to a wealthy Quaker family, Cope distinguished himself as a child prodigy interested in science. He published his first scientific paper at the age of 19. Though his father tried to raise Cope as a gentleman farmer, he eventually acquiesced to his son's scientific aspirations. Cope married his cousin and had one child. The family moved from Philadelphia to Haddonfield, New Jersey. Although Cope would maintain a residence and museum in Philadelphia in his later years, Cope had little formal scientific training, and he eschewed a teaching position for field work. He made regular trips to the American West, prospecting in the 1870s and 1880s, often as a member of United States Geological Survey teams. A personal feud between Cope and paleontologist Othniel Charles Marsh led to a period of intense fossil finding competition now known as the Bone Wars. Cope's financial fortunes soured after failed mining ventures in the 1880s, forcing him to sell off much of his fossil collection. He experienced a resurgence in his career toward the end of his life before dying on April 12, 1897. Though Cope's scientific pursuits nearly bankrupted him, his contributions helped to define the field of American paleontology. He was a prodigious writer, with 1,400 discovered, described, and named more than 1,000. 7 references, 8 selected works, 9 external links. Biography. Early life. Cope was taken on a sea trip to Boston 1 week after his 7th birthday. His notebook survives, including this page, and contains notes and drawings of his travels. Edward Drinker Cope was born on July 28, 1840, the eldest son of Alfred and Hannah Cope. The death of his mother when he was 3 years old seemed to have had little effect on young Edward, as he mentioned in his letters that he had no recollection of her. His stepmother, Rebecca Biddle, filled the maternal role. Cope referred to her warmly, as well as his younger stepbrother, James Biddle. Cope Alfred, an Orthodox member of the Religious Society of Friends or Quakers, operated a lucrative shipping business started by his father, Thomas P. Cope. In 1821 he was a philanthropist who gave money to the Society of Friends, the Philadelphia Zoological Gardens, and the Institute for Colored Youth. Edward was born and raised in a large stone house called Fairfield, whose location is now within the boundaries of Philadelphia, the 8 acres 32. Teaching their children to read and write at a very young age, and took Edward on trips across New England and to museums, zoos, and gardens. Cope's interest in animals became apparent at a young age, as did his natural artistic ability. Alfred intended to give his son the same education he himself had received at age 9. Edward was sent to a day school in Philadelphia, and in 1853, at the age of 12, Edward was sent to the Friends boarding school at Westtown, near Westchester, Pennsylvania. The school was founded in 1799. With fundraising by members of the Society of Friends Quakers, and provided much of the Cope family's education. The prestigious school was expensive, costing Alfred $500 in tuition each year, and in his first year, Edward studied algebra, chemistry, scripture, physiology, grammar, astronomy, and Latin. Edward's letters home requesting a larger allowance show he was able to manipulate his father, and he was, according to author and Cope biographer Jane Davidson, a bit of a spoiled brat. His letters suggest he was lonely at the school. It was the first time he had been away from his home for an extended period. Otherwise, Edward's studies progressed much like a typical boy. He consistently had less than perfect or not quite satisfactory marks for conduct from his teachers, and did not work hard on his penmanship lessons, which may have contributed to his often illegible handwriting. As an adult, Edward returned to Westtown in 1855, accompanied by 2 of his sisters. Biology began to interest him more that year, and he studied natural history texts in his spare time while at the school. He frequently visited the Academy of Natural Sciences. Edward often obtained bad marks due to quarreling and bad conduct. His letters to his father show he chafed at farm work and betrayed flashes of the temper for which he would later become well known. After sending Edward back to the farm for summer break in 1854 and 1855, Alfred did not return Edward to school after spring 1856. Instead, Alfred attempted to turn his son into a gentleman farmer, which he considered a wholesome profession that would yield enough profit to lead a comfortable life, and improve the undersized Edward's health until 1863. Cope's letters to his father continually expressed his yearning for a more professional scientific career than that of a farmer, which he called dreadfully boring. While working on farms, Edward continued his education on his own. In 1858, he began working part-time at the Academy of Natural Sciences, reclassifying and cataloging specimens, and published his first series of research results in January 1859. Cope began taking French and German classes with a former Westtown teacher. Though Alfred resisted his son's pursuit of a science career, he paid for his son's private studies instead of working the farm his father bought for him. Edward rented out the land and used the income to further his scientific endeavors. Alfred finally gave in to Edward's wishes and paid for university classes. Cope attended the University of Pennsylvania in the 1861 and/or 1862 academic years, studying comparative anatomy under Joseph Leidy, one of the most influential anatomists and paleontologists at the time. Cope asked his father to pay for a tutor in both German and French, not so much for their own sake, wrote Edward, but as for their value in enabling me to read their books of a literary or scientific character. During this period, he had a job recataloging the herpetological collection at the Academy of Natural Sciences, where he became a member at Leidy's urging. Cope's job lasted 2 years, and he visited the Smithsonian Institution on occasion, where he became acquainted with Spencer Baird, who was an expert in the fields of ornithology and ichthyology. In 1861, he published his first paper on salamandridae classification. Over the next 5 years, he published primarily on reptiles and amphibians. Cope's membership in the Academy of Natural Sciences and American Philosophical Society gave him outlets to publish and announce his work. Many of his early paleontological works were published by the Philosophical Society. European travels in 1863-1864. During the American Civil War, Edward traveled through Europe, taking the opportunity to visit the most esteemed museums and societies of the time. Initially, he seemed interested in helping out at a field hospital, but in letters to his father later on in the war, this aspiration seemed to disappear. Instead, Edward considered working in the American South to assist freed African Americans. Davidson suggests Edward's correspondence with Leidy and Ferdinand Hayden, who worked as field surgeons during the war, might have informed Edward of the horrors of the occupation. Edward was involved in a love affair. His father did not approve whether Edward or the unnamed woman whom he at one point intended to marry broke off the relationship is unknown, but he took the breakup poorly. Biographer and paleontologist Henry Fairfield Osborne attributed Edward's sudden departure for Europe as a method of keeping him from being drafted into the Civil War. Cope did write to his father from London on February 11, 1864, "I shall get home in time to catch and be caught by the new draft. I shall not be sorry for this, as I know certain persons who would be mean enough to say that I have gone to Europe to avoid the war." Eventually, Cope took the pragmatic approach and waited out the conflict. He may have suffered from mild depression during this period, and often complained of boredom despite his torpor. Edward proceeded with his tour of Europe, and met with some of the most highly esteemed scientists of the world during his travels through France, Germany, Great Britain, Ireland, Austria, Italy, and Eastern Europe, most likely with introductory letters from Leidy and Spencer Baird. In the winter of 1863, Edward met Othniel Charles Marsh while in Berlin. Marsh, age 32, was attending the University of Berlin. He held 2 university degrees in comparison to Edward's lack of formal schooling past 16, but Edward had written 37. House, etc., as well as her steady seriousness weigh far more with me than any of the traits which form the theme of poets. Cope's family approved of his choice, and the marriage took place in July 1865 at Pym's farmhouse in Chester County, Pennsylvania. The two had a single daughter, Julia Biddle Cope, born June 10, 1866. Cope's return to the United States also marked an expansion of his scientific studies. In 1864, he described several fishes, a whale, and the amphibian Amphibamus grandiceps. His first paleontological contribution. During the period between 1866 and 1867, Cope went on trips to western parts of the country. He related to his father his scientific experiences. To his daughter, he sent descriptions of animal life as part of her education. Cope found educating his students at Haverford a pleasure, but wrote to his father that he could not get any work done. He resigned from his position at Haverford and moved his family to Haddonfield, in part to be closer to the fossil beds of western New Jersey due to the time-consuming nature of his Haverford position. Cope had not had time to attend to his farm and had let it out to others, but eventually found he was in need of more money to fuel his scientific habits. Pleading with his father for money to pursue his career, he finally sold the farm in 1869. Alfred apparently did not press his son to continue farming, and Edward focused on his scientific career. He continued his continental travels, including trips to Virginia, Tennessee, and North Carolina. He visited caves across the region. He stopped these cave explorations after an 1871 trip to the Wyandotte Caves in Indiana, but remained interested in the subject. Cope had visited Haddonfield many times in the 1860s, paying periodic visits to the marl pits. The fossils he found in these pits became the focus of several papers, including a description in 1868 of Elasmosaurus platurus, and Lalaps Marsh accompanied him on one of these excursions. Cope's proximity to the beds after moving to Haddonfield made more frequent trips possible. The Copes lived comfortably in a frame house backed by an apple orchard. Two maids tended the estate, which entertained a number of guests. Cope's only concern was for more money to spend on his scientific work. The 1870s were the golden years of Cope's career, marked by his most prominent discoveries and rapid flow of publications. Among his descriptions were the Therapsid Lystrosaurus 1870, the Archosauromorph Champsosaurus 1876, and the Sauropod Amphicelius 1878, possibly the largest dinosaur ever discovered in the period of 1 year, from 1879 to 1880, Cope published 76. Faster reception abroad, and subsequently Marsh's reputation grew more rapidly than Cope's. Cope's Pine Street residence in autumn 1871, Cope began prospecting farther west to the fossil fields of Kansas. Leidy and Marsh had been to the region earlier, and Cope employed one of Marsh's guides, Benjamin Mudge, who was in want of a job. Cope's companion Charles Sternberg described the lack of water and good food available to Cope and his helpers on these expeditions. Cope would suffer from a severe attack of nightmare, in which every animal of which we had found trace during the day played with him at night. Formations, he wrote to his father, provided the most important find in geology I have ever made. The New Mexico Bluffs contained millions of years of formation and subsequent deformation, and were in an area which had not been visited by Leidy or Marsh. Being part of the survey had other advantages. Cope was able to draw on fort commissaries and defray publishing costs while there was no salary. His findings would be published in the annual reports the surveys printed. Cope brought Annie and Julia along on one such survey, and rented a house for them at Fort Bridger, but he spent more of his own money on these survey trips than he would have liked. Alfred died December 4, 1875, and left Edward with an inheritance of nearly $250,000. Alfred's death was a blow to Cope. His father was a constant confidant. The same year marked a suspension of much of Cope's field work and a new emphasis on writing up discoveries of the previous years. His chief publication of the time, The Vertebrata of the Cretaceous Formations of the West, was a collection of 303. Of the two houses into a museum where he stored his growing collection of fossils. Cope's expeditions took him across Kansas, Colorado, New Mexico, Wyoming, and Montana. His initial journey into the Clarendon beds of Upper Miocene and Lower Pliocene of Texas led to an affiliation with the Geological Survey of Texas. Cope's papers on the region constitute some of his most important paleontological contributions. In 1877, he purchased half the rights to the American Naturalist to publish the papers he produced at a rate so high, Marsh questioned their dating. Cope returned to Europe in August 1878 in response to an invitation to join the British Association for the Advancement of Sciences. Dublin meeting, he was warmly welcomed in England and France, and met with the distinguished paleontologists and archaeologists of the period. Marsh's attempts to sully Cope's reputation had made little impact on anyone save paleontologist Thomas Henry Huxley, who, according to Osborne, alone treated with coolness. Following the Dublin meeting, Cope spent 2 days with the French Association for the Advancement of Science. At each gathering, Cope exhibited dinosaur restorations by Philadelphia colleague John A. Ryder and various charts and plates from geological surveys of the 1870s led by Ferdinand Vandeveer Hayden. He returned to London on October 12, meeting with anatomist Richard Owen, ichthyologist Albert Gunther, and paleontologist H. G. Seeley. While in Europe, Cope purchased a great collection of fossils from Argentina. Cope never found time to described the collection, and many of the boxes remained unopened until his death. Bone War's main article, Bone War's illustration plate to Cope's 1870 description of several reptiles, including an improperly reconstructed Elasmosaurus foreground. Cope's relations with Marsh turned into a competition for fossils between the two, known today as the Bone Wars. The conflict's seeds began upon the men's return to the United States in the 1860s. Cope introduced his colleague to the Marl Pit owner Albert Voorhees. When the two visited the site, Marsh went behind Cope's back and made a private agreement with Voorhees. Any fossils that Voorhees's men found were sent back to Marsh at New Haven. When Marsh was at Haddonfield examining one of Cope's fossil finds, a complete skeleton of a large aquatic plesiosaur, Elasmosaurus, that had four flippers and a long neck, he commented that the fossil's head was on the wrong end, evidently stating that Cope had put the skull at the end of the vertebrae of the tail. Cope was outraged, and the two argued for some time until they agreed to have Leidy examine the bones and determine who was right. Leidy came, picked up the head of the fossil and put it on the other end. Cope was horrified, since he had already published a paper on the fossil with the error at the American Philosophical Society. He immediately tried to buy back the copies, but some remained with their buyers. Marsh and Leidy kept theirs. The whole ordeal might have passed easily enough had Leidy not exposed the cover-up at the next society meeting, not to alienate Cope, but only in response to Cope's brief statement where he never admitted he was wrong. Cope and Marsh would never talk to each other amicably again, and by 1873, open hostility had broken out between them. The rivalry between the two increased towards the latter half of the 1870s. In 1877, Marsh received a letter from Arthur Lakes, a schoolteacher in Golden, Colorado. Lakes had been hiking in the mountains near the town of Morrison with his friend, H.C. Beckwith, looking for fossilized leaves in the Dakota sandstone. Instead, the pair found large bones embedded in the rock. Lakes wrote that the bones were apparently a vertebra and a humerus bone of some gigantic saurian, while Lakes sent Marsh some 1,500 pounds of bone. He also sent Cope some of the specimens. Marsh published his finds first, and having been paid $100 for the finds, Lakes wrote to Cope that the samples should be forwarded to Marsh. Cope was offended by the slight. Meanwhile, Cope received bones from school superintendent Al Lucas in March 1877 from Cannon City. The remains were of a dinosaur even bigger than Lakes that Marsh had described. Word that Lakes had notified Cope of his finds galvanized Marsh into action. When Marsh heard from Union Pacific Railroad workers Wee Carlin and W. H. Reed about a vast boneyard northwest of Laramie in Como Bluff, Marsh sent his agent, Samuel Wendell Williston, to take charge of the digging. Cope, in response, learned of Carlin and Reed's discoveries and sent his own men to find bones in the area. The two scientists attempted to sabotage each other's progress. Cope was described as a genius and what Marsh lacked in intelligence, he easily made up for in connections. Marsh's uncle was George Peabody, a rich banker who supported Marsh with money, and a secure position at the Peabody Museum. Marsh lobbied John Wesley Powell to act against Cope and attempted to persuade Hayden to muzzle Cope's publishing. Both men tried to spy on the other's whereabouts and attempted to offer their collectors more money in the hopes of recruiting them to their own side. Cope was able to recruit David Baldwin in New Mexico and Frank Williston in Wyoming from Marsh. Cope and Marsh were extremely secretive as to the source of their fossils. When Henry Fairfield Osborne, at the time a student at Princeton, visited Cope to ask where to travel to look for fossils in the West, Cope politely refused to answer. When Cope arrived back in the United States after his tour of Europe in 1878, he had nearly 2 years of fossil findings from Lucas. Among these dinosaurs was Camarasaurus, one of the most recognizable dinosaur recreations of the time. The summer of 1879 took Cope to Salt Lake City, San Francisco, and north to Oregon, where he was amazed at the rich flora and the blueness of the Pacific Ocean. In 1879, the United States Congress consolidated the various government survey teams into the United States Geological Survey with Clarence King as its leader. This was discouraging to Cope because King named Marsh, an old college friend, as the chief paleontologist. The period of Cope's and Marsh's paleontological digs in the American West spanned from 1877 to 1892, by which time both men exhausted much of their financial resources. Later years illustration plate from Cope's The Vertebrata of the Tertiary Formations of the Far West, featuring the skulls of Kennedy from the John Day Epic in Oregon. The 1880s proved disastrous for Cope. Marsh's close association with the Geological Survey gave him the resources to employ 54. Realized he would not be able to best Marsh in cornering the market for bones, he had to release the collectors he had hired and sell his collections. During this period, he published 40 to 75. financial mismanagement, and attacked Powell for his geological classification errors and misspending of government-allocated funds. Marsh and Powell published their own side of the story and, in the end, little changed. No congressional hearing was created to investigate Powell's alleged misallocation of funds. While Cope and Marsh were not held responsible for any mistakes indirectly, however, the attacks may have been influential in Marsh's fall from power in the survey due to pressure from Powell over bad press. Marsh was removed from his position for the government surveys. Cope's relations with the president of the University of Pennsylvania soured, and the entire funding for paleontology in the government surveys was pulled. Cope took his sinking fortunes in stride in writing to Osborne about the articles. He laughed at the outcome, saying, "It will now rest largely with you whether or not I am supposed to be a liar and am actuated by jealousy and disappointment." I think Marsh is impaled on the horns of Monoclonius sphenicaris. Cope was well aware of his enemies and was carefree enough to name a species after a combination of Cope and hater, Anisonchus Cofader. Through his years of financial hardship, he was able to continue publishing papers. His most productive years were 1884 and 1885, with 79 and 62 papers published, respectively. The 1880s marked the publication of two of the best-known fossil taxa described by Cope, the Pelycosaur edificosaurus in 1882 and the early dinosaur Coelophysis in 1889. In 1889, he succeeded Leidy, who had died the previous year, as professor of zoology at the University of Pennsylvania. The small yearly stipend was enough for Cope's family to move back into one of the townhouses he had been forced to relinquish earlier in 1892, Cope then 52. $50,000. The purchase was financed by the donations from New York's High Society. Cope sold three other collections for $29,000, while his collection contained more than 13,000. Arrangements for surgery, but the plans were put on hold after a temporary improvement in Cope's health. Cope went to Virginia looking for fossils, became ill again, and returned to his home very weak. Osborne visited Cope on April 5, inquiring about Cope's health, but the sick paleontologist pressed his friend for his views on the origin of mammals. Word of Cope's illness spread, and he was visited by friends and colleagues. Even in a feverish condition, Cope delivered lectures from his bed. Cope died on April 12, 1897, 16 weeks short of his 57th birthday. Sternberg, still prospecting for Cope that spring, was woken by a liveryman who relayed word from Annie that Cope had died 3 days earlier. Sternberg wrote in his memoirs, "I had lost friends before, and I had known what it was to bury my own dead, even my firstborn son, but I had never sorrowed more deeply than I did over the news." Cope's Quaker funeral consisted of six men: Osborne, his colleague William Berryman Scott, Cope's friend Persifor Fraser, son-in-law Collins, Horatio Wood, and Harrison Allen. The six sat around Cope's coffin among the fossils and Cope's pets, a tortoise and a Gila monster, for what Osborne called a perfect Quaker silence. Gathering was spent in silence after the coffin was removed. The assembled began talking. Fraser recalled that each person remembered Cope differently, and few men succeeded so well in concealing from anyone. Bones were extracted and kept in a locked drawer to be studied by anatomy students. N5. Osborne listed Cope's cause of death as uremic poisoning, combined with a large prostate, but the true cause of death is unknown. Many believed Cope had died of syphilis contracted from the women with whom he fraternized during his travels in 1995. Davidson gained permission to have the skeleton examined by a medical doctor at the university. Dr. Maury Crickin, a professor of radiology, concluded no evidence of bony syphilis was found on Cope's skeleton. Public mentions of Cope's passing were relatively slight. The Naturalist ran four photographs, a six-page obituary by editor J.S. Kingsley, and a two-page remembrance by Fraser. The National Academy of Sciences official memoir was submitted years later and written by Osborne. The American Journal of Science devoted six paragraphs to Cope's passing, and incorrectly gave his age as 46. Cope was survived by his rival Marsh, who was suffering poor health. Evolution as a young man, Cope read Charles Darwin's Voyage of a Naturalist, which had little effect on him. The only comment about Darwin's book recorded by Cope was that Darwin discussed too much geology from the account of his voyage due to his background in taxonomy and paleontology. Cope focused on evolution in terms of changing structure, rather than emphasizing Geography and variation within populations. As Darwin had over his lifetime, Cope's views on evolution shifted. His original view, described in the paper On the Origin of Genera 1868, held that while Darwin's natural selection may affect the preservation of superficial characteristics in organisms, natural selection alone could not explain the formation of genera. Cope's suggested mechanism for this action was a steady progressive development of organization through what Cope termed a continual crowding backward of the successive steps of individual development. In Cope's view, during embryological development, an organism could complete its growth with a new stage of development beyond its parents, taking it to a higher level of organization. Later individuals would inherit this new level of development. Thus, evolution was a continuous advance of organization, sometimes slowly and other times suddenly. This view is known as the law of acceleration. Cope's beliefs later evolved to one with an increased emphasis on continual and utilitarian evolution with less involvement of a creator. He became one of the founders of the Neo-Lamarckism school of thought, which holds that an individual can pass on traits acquired in its lifetime to offspring. Although the view has been shown incorrect, it was the prevalent theory among paleontologists in Cope's time. In 1887, Cope published his own Origin of the Fittest, Essays in Evolution, detailing his views on the subject. He was a strong believer in the law of use and disuse, that an individual will slowly, over time, favor an anatomical part of its body so much that it will become stronger and larger as time progresses down the generations. The giraffe, for example, stretched its neck to reach taller trees and passed this acquired characteristic to its offspring in a developmental phase that is added to gestation in the womb. Cope's Theology of Evolution 1887 argued that consciousness comes from the mind of the universe and governs evolution by directing animals to new goals. According to Sedaris 2003, argued that organisms respond to changes in their environments by an exercise of choice. Consciousness itself, he maintained, was the principal force in evolution. Cope credited God with having built into evolution a life force that propelled organisms toward even higher levels of consciousness, personality, and legacy. One of the last photographs taken of Cope, third from right, during his attendance at the 1896 American Association for the Advancement of Science meeting in Buffalo. Julia assisted Osborne in writing a biography of her father, titled Cope, Master Naturalist. She would not comment on the name of the woman with whom her father had had an affair prior to his first European travel. Julia is believed to have burned any of the scandalous letters and journals Cope had kept, but many of his friends were able to give their recollections of the scandalous nature of some of Cope's unpublished routines. Charles R. Knight, a former friend, called Cope's mouth the filthiest, from hearsay that in heyday no woman was safe within five. Cope was raised as a Quaker, and was taught that the Bible was literal truth, although he never confronted his family about their religious views. Osborne writes that Cope was at least aware of the conflict between his scientific career and his religion. Osborne writes, if Edward harbored intellectual doubts about the literalness of the Bible, nature of the bird, Cope was against the modern view of women's rights, believing in the husband's role as protector. He was opposed to women's suffrage, as he felt they would be unduly influenced by their husbands in fewer than 40. See also biography Portal. Port Kennedy Bone Cave footnotes. Carrot Davidson found no evidence in any of the surviving Cope correspondence and papers that Alfred intended Edward to become part of his shipping business. She attributes Alfred's resistance to Edward's desire for a scientific career to old-fashionedness. Davidson, 25. Carrot. The exact dates of Cope's studies at the University of Pennsylvania are not known. Cope kept his admission slip for the 1861-1862 school year his entire life, but assuming that these slips were collected by university professors, this would suggest he never attended in the fall of 1861. Davidson, 20. Carat. Davidson writes that seemed to the reader, as it does the author, that Cope could have suffered some mild depression. She points to evidence including his letters where he complains of boredom, as well as betraying insights into the discrepancy between how he saw himself and how his colleagues described him. Davidson, 29. Carat. At one point, Cope deliberately and falsely claimed that a paper on Permian vertebrates had been published 3 weeks earlier, in part to get back at Marsh, who had heard about Cope's discoveries at a meeting and hurriedly wrote a paper about his own finds while claiming that he was the first to do so. Romer, 204. Carat. Cope was not alone in donating his brain. Poet Walt Whitman did so, as did Powell and Leidy. Cope's brain weighed 1,545. Carat AB Davidson, 12 Carat Davidson, 11 Carat Davidson, 15 Carat AB Osborne, 100 Carat Lanham, 63 Carat AB Davidson, 17 Carat Lanham, 64 Carat Davidson, 20 Carat Osborne, 80 Carat Osborne, 101 Carat Davidson, 21 Carat Osborne, 107 Carat AB Gill, 835 Carat Davidson, 22 Carat ABC Davidson, 26-27 Carat Lanham, 66 Carat AB Davidson, 29-30 Carat Osborne, 106 Carat Osborne, 138 Carat Davidson, 29 Carat AB Jaffe, 11 Carat Lanham, 67 Carat AB Jaffe, 48 Carat Osborne, 142 Carat ABC Osborne, 143 Carat Osborne, 146 Carat Davidson, 31 Carat Osborne, 144 Carat Davidson, 33 Carat Osborne, 145 Carat Osborne, 151-154 Carat Osborne, 155 Carat Osborne, 157-158 Carat Cope 1870 Carat Cope 1876 Carat Cope 1878 Carat Carpenter, 131 Carat Davidson, 43 Carat Cope, 216 Carat Osborne, 159-160 Carat Osborne, 167 Carat Jaffe, 583 Carat AB Osborne, 168 Carat Osborne, 183 Carat Osborne, 194 Carat Osborne, 200 Carat Jaffe, 63 Carat Gill, 837 Carat Cope, 217 Carat Osborne, 218 Carat Osborne, 233 Carat Davidson, 41 Carat Osborne, 243 Carat Osborne, 244 Carat Gallagher, 35 Carat Jaffe, 15 Carat Thompson, 229 Carat Lanham, 170-171 Carat Wilford, 105 Carat AB Lanham, 172 Carat Wilford, 106 Carat Lanham, 174-176 Carat AB Bakker Carat Jaffe, 106 Carat Jaffe, 257 Carat Osborne, 579 Carat Davidson, 42 Carat Osborne, P 269 Carat AB Lanham, 231 Carat Lanham, 233-237 Carat Lanham, 238 Carat Gill, 838 Carat Lanham, 242 Carat AB Lanham, 243-244 Carat Romer, 205 Carat Lanham, 249 Carat Lanham, 245 Carat Osborne, 585 Carat Pennock Carat Osborne, 403 Carat Osborne, 404 Carat Romer, 206 Carat Jaffe, 329-334 Carat Osborne, 408 Carat Osborne, 583 Carat Cope 1882 Carat Cope 1889 Carat Jaffe 349 Carat AB Lanham 267 Carat AB Jaffe 350 Carat AB Lanham 268 Carat Jaffe 355 Carat Jaffe 356 Carat American Museum of Natural History Carat AB Jaffe 356-357 Carat Jaffe 358 Carat Fowler 196 Carat Jaffe 359 Carat AB Lanham 269 Carat ABCD Jaffe 361 Carat AB Jaffe 362 Carat Jaffe 363 Carat Montgomery, 95 Carat Dodson Carat Associated Press Carat Davidson, 160 Carat Davidson, 161 Carat Jaffe, 366 Carat Davidson, 16 Carat Bowler, 250 Carat Bowler, 251-253 Carat Bowler, 259 Carat Polly Carat AB Lanham, 68 Carat Elroy Carat Cope, 126 Carat Randy Moore, Mark Decker, Sehoya Kotner Chronology of the Evolution Creationism Controversy 2010, p. 140 Carat Environmental Ethics, Ecological Theology, and Natural Selection Carat Gill, 830 Carat AB Davidson, 106-109 Carat Fowler, 197 Carat McConnell, Scott 2014 Whitmer Stone, The Fascination of Nature p. 59 self-published ISBN 978-0-692-22938-5 Carat Jaffe Carat Romer, 202 Carat Davidson, 23 Carat Davidson, 24 Carat Davidson, 169 Carat AB Davidson, 176 Carat Davidson, 182 Carat Academy of Natural Sciences, Bone Wars, Carat Jaffe, 338 Carat Colbert, 93 Carat Academy of Natural Sciences, History of the Ichthyology Department, Carat Haverford, Carat Nussbaum, 509 Carat Bacher et al. Carat 1882 Carat Regan, 1912 Carat American Society of Ichthyologists and Herpetologist Carat Levins.